Well, hello, everyone who is here with us. Welcome. I'm Arielle Katz. I'm the Director of Marketing at the Museum of Jewish Heritage, and I am also a pickle enthusiast. So both professionally and personally, very glad to be here with all of you as we celebrate National Pickle Month, along with our wonderful event partner, the Workers' Circle. Just a little bit about them. The Workers' Circle is a nonprofit organization that powers progressive Jewish identity through Jewish cultural engagement, Yiddish language learning, multi-generational education, and social justice activism and community building rooted in Yiddishkeit and heritage. You can check them out at www.circle.org. Here at the Museum of Jewish Heritage, our mission is to educate and learn from our diverse community in New York City and far beyond, as all of you are testament to, about Jewish heritage and life before, during, and after the Holocaust, which includes thousands of years of pickles. Our public programs at the museum support this mission by illuminating Jewish culture and storytelling, historic and current anti-Semitism, first-person accounts of survival and resistance, and much more, which you can see all at mjhnyc.org, where you can also become a member of the museum or make a donation to help sustain our work and our public events. We are especially excited just to plug an upcoming series of events to be hosting Summer Thursdays. It's starting next week. It's 5 Thursdays of literature, music, dinner, and drinks on the museum's second floor, which overlooks New York Harbor. It's very beautiful. If you're nearby, I really hope you'll join us. Great. Okay, so before we dive into the brine, I'm sorry, I can't help myself. I wrote so many puns when I was writing this introduction, and I'm saving you really from most of them. So that's the last one. Just a little bit of Zoom protocol. I will be off camera during the talk, but I'll be here in the chat if you need anything, any technical issues or anything like that. And if you have questions for our wonderful speakers, please do use the Q&A function below. It just helps us to keep track of everything. And we'll get to as many of your questions as we can following the conversation and the demo. Whew, okay, so now is the real pleasure part, which is to introduce you to our speakers. Sandor Katz is the author of 5 books: Wild Fermentation, The Art of Fermentation, The Revolution Will Not Be Microwaved, I love that, Fermentation as Metaphor, and his latest, Fermentation Journeys. Katz's books, along with the hundreds of fermentation workshops he has taught around the world, have helped to catalyze a broad revival of the fermentation arts. A self-taught experimentalist who lives in rural Tennessee, Katz is the recipient of a James Beard Award and many other honors. Ann Toback is the CEO of the Workers' Circle. The first woman to be CEO of the organization, Toback has served in her position for more than 14 years, establishing the Workers' Circle as a social justice organization that finds inspiration and power in Yiddish language and Eastern European activist tradition of resistance, resilience, and cultural engagement. Anne and the Workers' Circle work fiercely on the front lines in the struggle to build multiracial, multicultural democracy that both works and is accountable to every one of us. Thank you both so much for being here and for your work. Appreciate it so much. Take us away.
Thank you, and thank you, Arielle. I love the Museum of Jewish Heritage, and also a great place to visit and have a nosh in their amazing cafe. Sandor, this is like a dream come true. Your book has been inspiring me in my pickle journey for years and years. So let's get started. We have a really interesting audience. I'm seeing some of the incredible comments already. But the first question is, why fermentation? And can you give us a description of your own pickling origin story?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, I grew up in New York City on the Upper West Side. I mean, a block and a half from Zabar's. And, you know, I loved pickles as a kid. And, you know, I wasn't thinking a lot about how they were made, but I did notice that, you know, at some of my friends' houses, I would have pickles that had a very different flavor than the pickles that I was used to. And later I came to understand that the pickles that I grew up with, the Eastern European style sour and half sour pickles, don't have any vinegar added, and that the sourness is the result of fermenting the pickles under a saltwater brine solution. And, you know, the other kinds of pickles, which I, you know, I also have always liked, I don't think I've ever met a pickle I didn't like. But that those are made with vinegar, and vinegar is acetic acid, and the acid that results from the fermentation is lactic acid, and they have very different flavors, although they both can be very effective at preserving food. And I think because there are these sort of two different ways of making pickles, and I mean, really, there's way more than two ways of making pickles, but, you know, there's two major ways that, you know, you'll find around the United States. There's a lot of confusion about, you know, pickles and fermentation. And, you know, the way I like to explain it to people is that pickling and fermentation are overlapping concepts. We could make a Venn diagram, and there's a place where they meet. And that would be like, you know, this jar of pickles right here, or for that matter, this jar of sauerkraut or a jar of kimchi, you know, any kind of like sour fermented vegetables, you know, that's a kind of a pickle. And those are made by fermentation. But of course, there's many other fermented foods that are not a pickle at all. A loaf of bread is not a pickle. A bottle of wine is not a pickle. So it's only the fermented foods where you're preserving something in an acidic ingredient that would be a pickle. And then, of course, you know, you can pour a hot vinegar solution over anything, over, you know, cucumbers or onions, or, you know, for that matter, hard boiled eggs or pig's feet. I mean, you know, people pickle all kinds of things under a vinegar solution. And of course, the vinegar is a product of fermentation, but the process of making the pickle typically does not involve fermentation. Although there are hybrid methods where people add a small proportion of vinegar to a brine in which they want the pickles to ferment.
And talking about fermentation and particular the salt method, or what we call that kosher. Can you connect kosher dills to fermentation? Is that what distinguishes what we now call kosher?
Yeah, sure. I mean, the same thing that I just called sour pickles or half sour pickles, like those are widely known. I mean, when I was in New York, I never heard them called kosher dills. I just heard them called sour pickles. But when I left New York, I learned that like the code word for that kind of a pickle is a kosher dill pickle. You know, but you know, I mean, from having had the opportunity to teach in contemporary Eastern Europe, I mean, I've learned that you know, you don't like the old Levy's rye bread ad. You're like, you don't have to be Jewish to love a sour pickle. You know, it's broadly enjoyed, you know, by people around Eastern Europe, you know, regardless of whether or not they're of Jewish descent.
Sure, and there's health benefits to what we're now calling sour, half sour, kosher dills.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, that's a huge, you know, comparing the two different styles of pickles. I mean, one of the reasons why vinegar pickles have become so prominent on supermarket shelves is that once you pour a hot vinegar solution over the vegetables and heat process that, it can just sit without refrigeration on a shelf indefinitely. Mm-hmm. Whereas the sour pickles, the brined pickles, the fermented pickles, they're much more dynamic. If you want to store them for any length of time, you need to store them, you know, either in an earth temperature cellar or in a refrigerator. And if you leave them at room temperature, I mean, they won't become dangerous. The acidity will really protect them from any kind of like pathogenic organisms. However, the biggest challenge with cucumber pickles is keeping them crispy. And there are enzymes that will break down the pectins, which are what make them crispy and crunchy. And so they can get soft and mushy. And if you keep them at ambient temperature for any length of time, those enzymes will activate and make the pickles get soft and mushy. So, you know, they're much more dynamic and realistically, they need to be refrigerated if you want to, you know, store them for any length of time.
Right.
And in terms of health benefits, you know, one of the reasons they're so dynamic is that, you know, they're teeming with, all of these lactic acid bacteria. And, you know, lactic acid bacteria are very beneficial to us. We all have lactic acid bacteria in our gut. But, you know, eating live sour pickles, eating sauerkraut, eating kimchi, eating yogurt, you know, like so many different kinds of, you know, fermented foods, if they haven't been cooked or heat processed, you know, it's a way of replenishing and diversifying bacteria in the gut, which can have all kinds of benefits for us in terms of digestion, in terms of immune function, and really beyond that. I mean, there's this whole new area of research looking at, you know, mental health and how, you know, bacteria-rich foods, you know, can actually enhance mental health because bacteria in our gut play such an important role in regulating chemicals such as serotonin that have so much impact on how we think and how we feel.
That's incredible. And it's also, it's sort of a counter to this movement that I'm seeing in the United States to spend a fortune on probiotics and other things when you really can get them in easily fermented foods and maybe even more benefits than packaged probiotics, or, you know, depending.
There actually was some recent research suggesting that, you know, taking probiotics that are billions of copies of a single cell, you know, might actually hinder biodiversity in the gut rather than helping to build it.
And pickles actually are just a positive, and that fermentation, the lactobacillic fermentation is a very positive piece, a positive thing to eat for your gut. So it's got a lot of benefits.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, in there's a lot of lore about pickle brine as a miracle cure. So, you know, when you finish that jar of pickles, like, don't pour the brine down the drain. You know, you can sip it, you can incorporate it into salad dressings, into soups, into sauces. I mean, it has really many applications.
It's also a very popular drink, or semi-popular drink, with vodka. It's in place of a martini. That's a lot of fun. Pickle brine, especially the homemade variety, is absolutely delicious. And I just want to let people know, I'm seeing incredible comments. Just to give you our schedule, we're going to be talking. Sandor is going to be demoing pickling, and then we're going to get to some of your comments and questions. And they're all incredible. People are sharing their pickling stories on the chat, even as we speak. You referenced Eastern Europe and the Ashkenazic Jewish tradition, Sandor. And just to share, that's the part of pickling that brought me into pickling about 14, 15 years ago, when I learned how to ferment in the jar. And Sandor was showing you the jar. When you're fermenting your own jar of pickles, you're really copying a process that the Eastern European Jewish community brought here in the early 1900s. And it's one way we can tangibly connect to that heritage. You went there, Sandor. Do you want to talk a little bit about that pickling tradition that was brought here?
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, there are many, many, many different kinds of pickles in the world, and you know, in a lot of different cultures and culinary traditions, you know, people, you know, enjoy pickles as, you know, an accent to the meal, as a condiment, as a culinary enhancement. And I, you know, I just happened to sort of like grab a few of my books about pickling, but, you know, this is an amazing book, Usha's Pickle Digest, that's about Indian pickles. And, you know, Indian pickling is a vast, vast realm. A couple of books about a Russian cuisine, but in a Russian cuisine, there's a lot of interesting pickling that people do. Korean cuisine, I mean, you know, we might think of kimchi as being one thing, but there's, you know, there's infinite variation on how people make kimchi. Japanese cuisine has some of the most varied pickles. Chinese cuisine has tons of pickling. You know, I know that Persian cuisine, you know, Lebanese and other Middle Eastern cuisines. I mean, you know, there's a lot of different kinds of pickles in the world. But, you know, because, you know, my grandparents all came from Russia and Belarus and Poland and Lithuania, you know, it's the Eastern European ones that I grew up with and that, you know, really have become part of the culture of New York in particular. And so, you know, that's the flavor that I craved. And when I started playing around with fermentation, you know, that was, you know, something that was a high priority for me to learn how to make.
Yeah, it's something that really connects so many people, Eastern European and otherwise. I just wanted to share, I've had the privilege of knowing many people who are survivors of the Holocaust who came here after the war, and even some people who came before the war who were born in Eastern Europe. And they all talk about having barrels in their homes, especially if they lived in the countryside. And one barrel would be filled with cucumber pickles and one would be filled with sauerkraut. And that was something that was a story that I've heard multiple times, and a real sense of joy when the people talked about it. And I'm always interested in what that must have been like, being in a rather small house with a barrel of fermenting sauerkraut and cucumbers in the middle of winter, for example. And I want to encourage everyone, when you make your own pickles, to think about that, because one jar has such a powerful scent, odor, if you will. The idea of being around a barrel. Now, have you tried that, Sandor? Have you tried these major, you know, a major amount?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I mean, not so much with cucumber pickles, but with sauerkraut. I mean, I literally got a 55-gallon oak barrel that had been used by the Jack Daniel's distillery, which is just about 30 miles from where I live. And, you know, I filled it up with shredded cabbage and made beautiful sauerkraut in it in my cellar. And, you know, now I have other vessels that are that big, and I make big batches sometimes, and, you know, and it works out great. And, you know, the thing is with a big batch, and I mean, just with my life of, you know, fermenting a lot and teaching about fermentation, I feel like I live my life in a cloud of, sauerkraut aroma. And some people are very put off by it. I mean, I would say I get emails every couple of months from people who are like, oh my God, I love to make sauerkraut, but my partner hates the smell of it. You know, what can I do? Can you help me save my relationship? And, you know, the funniest solution I ever heard was somebody who sort of ran a little tube out of their fermentation vessel and out the window, so that the byproducts, the sulfur compounds, I mean, that's really what people find objectionable, sulfur compounds, but so that they would go out the window instead of into the apartment.
Wow. I understand the love of pickles, but that really is going an enormous distance. And someone on the chat did remind me it's aroma, not scent, not smell. I'll take aroma. And you caught that. We talk about Ashkenazic. Do you have any other Jewish traditions? We were speaking before about Sephardim or Mizrahi. I know there's Persian pickling, and of course there was a vast Jewish community in Persia. What other Jewish traditions have you come across with pickling?
I mean, really not a lot, other than the Ashkenazi traditions. I mean, you know, I imagine that they exist in other places. Persian pickling, you know, there's a word torshi that they use in Persian pickles, but I've seen that word used in describing pickles from like Bulgaria, Romania, you know, all the way to Persia. So, you know, that's a word associated with pickling, and sometimes that describes something that's brined and fermented, and sometimes that's used to describe something that's made with vinegar. And in fact, in a lot of traditions, you know, that historically were primarily traditions of brining, with the increased availability of cheap vinegar and the sort of advantage in terms of longer term stability of vinegar pickles, you know, some of them have been largely replaced. But you know, I mean, to me, it's about the flavor, you know, and you know, the flavor of a brined pickle is just very distinctive and very special. And because I grew up around it, it's just like, that's the pickle that I crave. So those are the pickles that I generally make. I mean, if I have a huge glut of cucumbers, I mean, you know, I'll make bread and butter pickles or other kinds of pickles that I can heat process and you know, can sit in the pantry for months or years, but you know, more often I'm fermenting pickles.
And when you say pickles, do you have a favorite vegetable to pickle outside of, let's say, cucumbers?
Well, yeah, sure. I mean, you know, this is all like, you know, this is a daikon sauerkraut. I mean, this I'm making like 50 gallons a year of, and you know, giving it to my neighbors and friends, eating it every day. You know, I love this, but you know, it's because this is very stable, and you know, I made this last November. This has only been in the refrigerator for the last week or so. It was in my cellar the whole time. Cucumbers are the most challenging vegetable to pickle because, you know, they will just get softer and mushier faster than any other vegetable. So, you know, the daikons, if I left them long enough in a warm environment, they too would become soft and mushy, but it would take a lot longer than cucumbers will. And when we get to the demo, you know, really mostly that's going to consist of, you know, tips to try to keep your cucumber pickles crunchy, because that's the challenge.
Yeah, we're getting questions. We've already had a couple of questions about how to keep your cucumbers crunchy, why do they get soft? And somebody just asked, why do sometimes they get hollow in the center? But before we do that, I do want to point out some really great comments in the chat, and we'll be answering more questions after. Yaffa Goldschmidt talks about the Sephardim pickle watermelon and beetroot, which sounds fantastic.
And then someone else was saying that their Sephardic grandmother made garlic dill brine pickles. So I guess that this style of pickles is not necessarily exclusive to, you know, Eastern European lineages.
Yeah. And someone talked about turnips here. So we're getting all sorts of interesting comments. It's really incredible. There's hundreds of people on this webinar right now, and we're getting many, many comments and stories. Pickling is just such an incredible tradition.
Literally, you can pickle anything. I mean, I have a friend who is a Cherokee, and in his Cherokee tradition, people pickle ears of corn, whole ears of corn. And that's delicious, pickled corn. But you know, anything you have a lot of, you could potentially pickle.
It makes me just want to, you know, go crazy. And I guess that's the beauty of this. We really can, even in small New York apartments.
Right. Oh, and I see someone just mentioned tomatoes, and, you know,
yes,
green tomatoes are another, you know, classic one. You know, my grandfather would let me eat all of the cucumber pickles, but he was into the pickled green tomatoes, which is as a kid was a little bit too sour and too scary for me.
So people, why don't we move into the demo, and then, because there's so many comments and questions. And I do want to also comment, a couple of people brought up pickled fish. So we do have a tradition of pickled lox, pickled herring. I guess that is that primarily an Eastern European tradition too?
Well, I mean, also Nordic. Norway, Sweden, like, you know, there's a lot of pickled fish available. You know, mostly that's in vinegar brine, but, you know, there's this, you know, somewhat notorious Swedish pickled herring called surströmming, which is a low salt fermented herring, which is, you know, really delicious, but has a very specific flavor that, you know, not everybody loves. You can pickle things beyond vegetables, fruits. There's a, particularly in Russian cuisine, there's a lot of pickling of fruits. Indian pickling, a lot of pickling of green fruits. So like, you know, green mango pickles, for example. Pickling is an expansive practice, you know, just where, you know, based on what people had a lot of. And I noticed there was a question about pickling lettuce. I don't know. I mean, there was, I did read an article about like Jews from Ukraine making lettuce kvass, which is like a liquid infusion of lettuce fermented. Mm-hmm. And I've played around with that. I would say in terms of pickling lettuce itself, probably the varieties that are firmer, like a romaine or something like that, would have more substance to them. And thinner leaves of lettuce would just sort of collapse in the course of being pickled.
Yeah, I was just thinking that they're so small. I have tried kvass. I think it's an interesting taste. It's not one that I have grown an affection for.
I love kvass. I write about how to make kvass in my books, but, you know, kvass is like fermented dry rye bread, but it's so iconic in Russian culture that like any sour drink is called kvass. Like kombucha, which was very popular in Russia 100 years ago, one of the names for it was tea kvass. And beetroot kvass has become quite popular.
That I enjoy. I like beets, but I was in Belarus and I tried their local kvass, and they're very territorial. They're very proud of kvass wherever you go, and it's a taste you have to grow used to, I find.
a lot of these flavors are acquired tastes. The first time I tasted kvass, and I made it from a written description, but it was like, I mean, I'd never had kvass in my life, and it was like going home. It just was like, oh my God, I can't believe how delicious this is. I can't believe I've never had this before.
It's incredible. It's a lot of fun, and it also is really, really healthy for you. That's how it was described to me a decade ago. I'm seeing pickled shark came up. There's really a lot, but people seem in particular talking about pickles in barrels, and we're lucky, we still have some pickle guys on the Lower East Side, and I tend to agree. There's nothing like going there and having a vast array of pickled vegetables and fruits and getting them straight from the barrels. There's something very, very fun and delicious about it.
Yeah. But, you know, it's the same concept, whether you do it in a jar this size or a jar this size or a ceramic crock or a wooden barrel, or like most of the barrel ones these days are in plastic barrels. The process is the same. And generally fermenting vegetables is very easy to scale up.
Yeah, Well, and that leads us, why don't you start your demo and take us through the best steps for pickling cucumbers and give us some tips to keep them crisp.
Okay, great. And I mean, you did ask about pickle, about bloating of pickles. And, you know, basically one of the reasons why you generally want to use small pickling cucumbers is to avoid that. If you use larger pickles, you know, often carbon dioxide from the fermentation will just get stuck inside, and that's what the bloating is. So if you use, you know, small pickling style cucumbers, those are the ones that generally work the best. Now, I have them sitting in when I started this, they were in an ice water bath. Now, they're just in a water bath. So, you know, that's one thing that really helps crisp them up is like get them really cold before you start. So I always put them in an ice water bath. The other thing that I've done with almost all the cucumbers is I've scraped off the residue of the blossom. So I saved one where I have it. So, you know, every cucumber has a stem end. And if the stem is broken off, that just appears like a little white fleshy bit. And then the other side where the blossom was, there's generally a little bit of a brown residue. Which maybe you can see. And so, you know, I'll just take each pickle and just like scrape away with the edge of a paring knife, or you can even use your fingernail for that. Just scrape away any residue of the blossom because, you know, there's these enzymes that break down the pectins, and they are just found in greatest concentration in any residue of the blossom. So you want to scrape away any residue of the blossom. You have your cucumbers in a ice water solution. You want to use pickling variety cucumbers, generally small ones that are firm. If they're not firm, that means there's already a pocket inside of them, and that's going to fill with carbon dioxide, and that's going to be what bloats. You know, then meanwhile, you have your vessel prepared. And in this case, I'm just going to use this is a half a gallon size mason jar. Now, I always add grape leaves, and grape leaves are another way to help keep the cucumbers crunchy. So I'll just take a handful of grape leaves and put them in here. You know, if you don't know where to get grape leaves, you know, any of the vendors at a farmer's market, if you get to know them, could potentially bring you grape leaves because, you know, most cleared fields will have some trees on the edge that have wild grapevines growing up them. You know, you can potentially use it's about the tannins. So people sometimes use sour cherry leaves, horseradish leaves, other kinds of leaves. I've heard of people using oak leaves. I've heard of people taking a tea bag and putting that in. So, you know, there are other ways that you can get some tannins in there, which will help to slow down these enzymes if you don't have access to grape leaves. Then I take my garlic. I always use garlic. You know, one thing is that you don't have to peel the garlic. What I do is I take whole heads of garlic and I just cut them in half. And then the flavor of the garlic will just infuse into my brine solution. So I'm going to just go put my four halves of garlic in there. And then dill, ideally, I would use flowering heads of dill. But my dill is just not that fully developed yet. So I'm just going to use dill seeds. You know, this is not rocket science. You don't have to worry about extreme precision. You know, if you love the flavor of dill or the flavor of garlic, add more. If you want less, add less. Not everybody uses dill. I mean, you know, the pickles I grew up with were with dill. I was teaching in Poland a few years ago, and my students got into a bit of a heated argument. And some of them like said, oh, dill's gross in a pickle. You need to use allspice as a seasoning in a pickle. So, you know, people have different ideas about the appropriate seasoning of the pickle. Then I just pack my cucumbers in, and then I'll pour a brine over it. So I'm going to, as I'm packing the cucumbers in, I'm going to talk a little bit about the brine. So, you know, basically you want to, use as little brine as possible to cover the vegetables. The more brine you use, the more you're going to be diluting the flavor of the vegetables. So, generally, whatever the size of your vessel, you want to figure that it'll be at least half full of vegetables and less than half of it will be brine. So, since this is a 2-quart vessel, I have prepared 1 quart of water to make into brine. I actually measured out a liter rather than a quart because the brine strength that I typically like to use is a 5% brine, and it's all just much easier in the metric system. So, a liter weighs a kilogram, and so a 5% brine needs 50 grams of salt in a liter to make 5%. If you tried to figure that out in the imperial system, you'd have just crazy fractions.
I've never actually done a percentage. I've always just had I add 2 tablespoons or, sort of a trial and error. Is that one of the
problems? That's totally fine. Okay. That's totally fine too. And you can always even if you measure it, you always want to taste it the next day after the salt has had a chance to absorb into the vegetables so that, you make sure it's to your liking. So, okay. Now I've packed all of the cucumbers in tightly. There's 1 cucumber that didn't fit. My estimating was pretty good. So I pour them all in there, and now I have my liter of water. Then this is 50 grams of salt, which is roughly 3 tablespoons, but different salts have different densities. A tablespoon of big salt, coarse salts will be a little different than a tablespoon of fine salt. So, weight is a more precise way, but as I said, it just doesn't necessarily require precision. And then I just mix it. And some people really emphasize boiling the water first and mixing salt into boiled water. Certainly if you're, working with water out of a municipal tap, boiling would be great to get most of the chlorine to evaporate. I have nice spring water, so I'm not really worrying about that. And, you just have to basically do 30 seconds of stirring, and then you can get the salt to dissolve in, in your cold water.
So there's a few good questions related to this.
Okay.
As far as salt, this was Carol. Carol just said, does iodized salt matter? That was on my brain too. What happens with iodized salt?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the literature would really suggest that you stay away from iodized salt. I use unrefined sea salts. Then they have traces of iodine. And because I've just done so many demonstrations of this stuff with whatever people hand me, I've learned that there's not enough iodine in iodized salt to inhibit the fermentation in any way. I wouldn't worry about it. I mean, kosher salt works great. The biggest thing I would say is, don't delay trying this to have to get some specific kind of salt. Whatever kind of salt you have in your kitchen is going to work fine. Whether it's unrefined sea salts, whether it's kosher salt, whether it's iodized table salt, you don't have to be precious about it. You can work with what you've got.
And another, there's a few interesting questions too. Someone asked if they can slice the pickles, what happens? Will they be less crisp?
Yeah, I mean, I have found that I get the crispiest, crunchiest pickles if I use small pickling cucumbers and leave them whole. You know, if what I have to work on is big slicing cucumbers, then I'll definitely cut them into pieces and ferment either, you know, slices or spears or chunks of them. You know, and I generally wouldn't ferment them as long because they have more of a tendency to get soft.
Right. I had always understood that the fermentation was actually the bacteria eating through or getting through the skin of the pickle. Is that true, or is that kind of a focus?
Well, I mean, the fermentation is the is the bacteria consuming carbohydrates from the cucumber and metabolizing them into acids, but, you know, it'll penetrate, you know, through the skin, you know, once it's submerged, it'll penetrate very quickly through the skins. One thing you want to be really aware of is vegetables floating at the top. So, you know, if I do this in a big vessel, like a cylindrical ceramic crock, I might take a plate that fits inside and just have a plate on the top, weighting everything down. If you're doing it in a jar, these days you can buy like little glass discs like this, or, you know, somebody gave me a little homemade ceramic disc, another little homemade ceramic disc, but just like a little weight just to make sure the vegetables stay under the brine can really help. And, you know, and then if you put a lid on the jar, just be aware that it needs to off gas. So you're going to need to, you know, after a day or two, just loosen that lid to let the carbon dioxide that's formed out, or you can just leave it loose. Now, you know, the million-dollar question is, how long do I ferment it, and how will I know when it's ready? And, you know, we have people in so many different places and climates. And, you know, if you are, you know, if you are where, you know, my Ashkenazi ancestors were, if you're in, you know, if you're in Russia, you're in Poland, when cucumbers are ripe in the summertime, it's just not that hot. And you're probably fermenting them for several weeks. On the other hand, I live in Tennessee, and if I left these on the counter at ambient temperature for 3 weeks to ferment, like, I would have baby food at the end of that. You know, I would just have like mushy pickles. So, you know, what I'll typically do is ferment them like 4 or 5 days on the counter until the color like begins to change. So you can see the color of a fresh cucumber contrasted against the color of one that's already been pickled. So I just wait for the color to change, which usually be like 3-4 days. And then once the color changes, I'll just bury them in the back of the refrigerator and leave them for like, you know, 3 more weeks in the refrigerator before I eat them, because the lactic acid bacteria will continue to function at refrigerator temperatures. They'll be slowed down by the lower temperature, but they'll continue to function. You know, if you had like a 60 degree space, like, you know, you could just ferment this for, you know, many, many weeks, and it would just become more and more delicious.
A good question is, can you reuse the brine?
Okay, this is a great question. And I would say up until about 7 years ago, I would have told people absolutely not. Like, you want to remake a brine every single time you make pickles. And, you know, certainly you wouldn't want to reuse a brine where the cucumbers started to get soft already, or you had any other kind of a problem with them. But you can reuse brine. And, you know, when I went to China in search of the historical roots of sauerkraut, because all of the historical literature says that the idea of fermenting vegetable under a brine really came from China, and that the nomadic people of Central Asia sort of spread the method westward into Europe. But in China, I learned a method called Pao-cai. And this brine is I started these when I got back from that trip at the beginning of 2017. And so for more than 6 years, I've been working with this brine. Now, over time, I have to add more salt. You can't just, because like, you know, that 5% brine, once it absorbs into the cucumbers, you're going to end up with an average saltiness of under 2.5%. And so, you know, you'll need to add more salt if you want to reuse a brine. You probably want to add more garlic, more dill, because those flavors will migrate out with the cucumbers. And so with my Pao-cai brine, I use very different kinds of seasoning profile. I use Sichuan peppercorns and star anise and licorice and ginger. But, you know, I replenish the spices. I replenish the salt over time. But after the first batch of pickles in here, each subsequent batch is much faster because there's a greater concentration of the lactic bacteria.
Oh, that's fascinating, because I had always heard you need to, you know, you couldn't reuse the brine. So that is a new... Well,
I think that there are trade-offs. I mean, I think that, you know, particularly with cucumber pickles, like there is this issue of the enzymes. And if you, you know, if you put in a brine that's already rich in those enzymes, you might end up with your cucumbers getting softer faster. I don't typically reuse the brine on my pickles, but you know, now I can't be hard and fast saying you would never reuse brine, because I've been working with these pickles where I do reuse the brine. So you know, it definitely can be done, and you can experiment with it.
So I'm looking, there's some, you were speaking about the tannins, and I put in the chat, I always use dried bay leaves just because they're so simple to come by. But someone asked about using rye bread, and I hadn't heard of that.
Sure. I mean, you know, people whose families are from Romania always talk about putting a piece of rye bread on the top. I corresponded for a while with this guy who was in his 70s. He lived around DC, and he was spending his retirement like trying to create controlled experiments of all of his mother's folklore about pickling and cooking. And so, you know, he, from his experiment, he decided that, you know, there was no, discernible difference between the pickles made with a piece of rye bread on top and the ones made without a piece of rye bread on top. But definitely it's a way that people make pickles. And, you know, nothing that's a way that has worked for people is wrong to do. It might not be necessary to do, but it, you know, it adds another dimension to them. I saw a really important question that I want to address, because I think that this is like the biggest anxiety that people have. And the question was, it was about safety. You know, how do you know you're not, you know, endangering yourself or the other people who are going to eat them? And, you know, fermenting vegetables is as safe as food gets. Vegetables get safer than they are raw when you ferment them. You know, we read every year about, you know, people getting sick from outbreaks on, you know, this year it was red onions, one year it was lettuce, one year it was tomatoes. You know, clearly there's the possibility that vegetables can be exposed to bacteria that can make us sick. And usually the story is runoff from a field with animals uphill washes over a field with vegetables. And so, you know, that can happen. But if you took those and fermented them, the lactic acid bacteria that would build up and produce lactic acid, that rising level of acidity would destroy the pathogenic bacteria. So, you know, just try not to worry about safety. The things that can go wrong are all aesthetic things. Like if your cucumbers turn out to be mushy, you might spit it out, but it's not going to hurt you. And so, you know, just pickling is extremely safe. Like the organisms that can make us sick cannot survive in a highly acidic environment. And, you know, somebody asked about using litmus paper. I mean, sure, you can use litmus paper, or you can buy an electronic pH meter, but, you know, it's really unnecessary for home fermentation. You know, you can smell and you can taste the acidity. You know, commercial producers basically have to test the pH of each batch. And, you know, once the magic number in the US is 4.6, once you reach a pH of 4.6, you know, it is understood that, you know, none of the pathogens can survive.
So someone wants to know how many days of fermentation till those dangerous organisms are killed.
I mean, it depends on the temperature. You know, I mean, fewer days in a warmer environment, but you'll have better pickles if you do it in a cooler environment and let it go a few more days. But, you know, when I was working on the art of fermentation, you know, I got a bunch of like litmus papers, and there's people who sell little like lactobacillus starter cultures, and they're big, you know, which is, I, to me, a totally exploitative product, because like all plants growing out of soil on planet Earth have lactic acid bacteria. You don't need to add the bacteria. They're already always there. But these people who were selling a powdered starter for fermenting vegetables, you know, were trying to convince me that like it makes the process safer. So I was like, okay, let's see how much faster can we reach the sort of safe number. And, you know, it was like one day faster if I added powder bacteria than if I didn't in my like limited controlled experiment. But what I would also say to the person worrying about that is like, I hope you're not worrying about eating raw vegetables, just because there is this tiny theoretical possibility that occasionally people get sick. I mean, you know, vegetables in general are extremely safe. And, you know, each day you pickle them where the pH gets lower, they get even safer.
I wanted to just put in one, not a warning, just advice. If you don't burp, or that's what I always call it, when, if you don't unscrew the jar and let some of the gases out, if you keep the jar closed for too long, what you may get is a buildup of the gas. And the worst I've had is just coming back and seeing some of the liquid, you know, coming out of the jar. I've heard sometimes it can be a little more explosive, but not really explosive. It just, you'll get some liquid kind of popping out of the jar. So you do need to kind of monitor that gas if you keep it shut tight.
And the other thing is that, you know, as the fermentation begins and it starts forming carbon dioxide, it'll lift everything up. So if your jar is like almost full as this one is, then you should expect a little bit of leakage, and that's not a big deal, but, you know, don't put it on top of your grandparents' wedding photos or your passport or other, you know, important papers. You know, put it on the kitchen counter, maybe put it on a plate. And then it's not a big deal if it does spill over a tiny bit.
Someone was asking about the mold that can grow. Is that okay? Is it safe to consume?
Yeah, so I mean, it's very rare that mold grows. Usually what grows is a phenomenon called calm yeast. And it's this little sort of, you know, white layer on the top, totally normal, totally harmless. You know, if you observe it forming, definitely try to remove it as best you can, but it'll dissipate into the brine and you probably won't be able to remove all of it. And don't worry about it. It's totally safe. If, on the other hand, you have like a cucumber sticking out of the brine and it's just in the air, especially in an open vessel or a vessel with a lot of airspace, then, I mean, that could start to grow a mold on it. And the way I would approach that, if it's just like one single cucumber sticking out like an iceberg, is I would just discard that cucumber. I just pull that cucumber out and discard it. But generally what can grow on the surface where there's oxygen is calm yeast, and, you know, it's almost inevitable, especially because, you know, cucumbers are ripe in the summer. and the temperatures are high or relatively high in the summer wherever you are. And so, in warm environments, calm yeast is very, very common. You know, different things that, I mean, there definitely are physical systems for fermentation that are designed and engineered in ways that protect the surface from oxygen. So, you know, that's one way to completely avoid that issue. What I saw, the woman who taught me how to make Pao-cai in China, she would pour a little bit of liquor on. If she had calm yeast, she would pour some baijiu, which is a Chinese style of liquor, and basically the liquor floats to the top. The alcohol kills that yeasty layer at the top, and then it evaporates. So I thought that was a very interesting approach. I've done that a little bit, but I mean, at this point, it just doesn't put me off. Like I just remove it, and it's just not a big deal for me. Try not to be too freaked out if you get a little bit of funky surface growth. It's generally just this harmless calm yeast. When I have seen molds, they've been white hairy molds will succeed the calm yeast sometimes. Those are generally regarded as harmless. Some people just remove a top layer and eat what's below, and some people are too worried about that and throw the whole thing away. Whichever of those suits you.
I see. There's two questions I want to make sure we get to before, and we're going to go, I think, a little bit over if people have so many questions. One is, and I've heard this before, people are worried, they want to know, do you have to sterilize the jars? And I want to say, I never do. I just wash my jars really well before I start. And I do reuse jars from supermarkets on a regular basis.
Me too. And honestly, my perspective about sterilizing things is that's a fantasy that we've been sold. And there's all kinds of chemicals you could buy that would sterilize the thing. And then you'd rinse it with your water that's not sterile, and you'd put it in your drying rack that's not sterile, and your hands that aren't sterile would be handling it, and your air in your apartment isn't sterile. So, it's just like the point is that there's a critical mass of these bacteria that we want on the vegetables, and the random assortment of ambient bacteria that are going to end up being on the jar or on your hands as you're handling it are completely insignificant. So cleanliness is important. Clean tools, clean hands, clean vessel, but soap and water is really perfectly adequate.
What I do find is when you're reusing jars, sometimes the top will start to, you'll see it being eaten away, I think, by the salt content. Then I might throw it away, and you can often get you can get replacements.
This is the golden age of mason jar lids. You can just buy, this is a wooden lid with a plastic insert just to sort of make it a little bit more airtight. This works really great. You can get plastic lids. The metal part of the lid can certainly corrode both right from the salt and from the acidity.
But beyond that, I've never worried a lot. Now, I do think sometimes this might be people confusing the canning process, where I know people are very careful this isn't that.
Canning is almost the diametrical opposite of fermentation, because in canning, you're trying to sort of sterilize everything in a jar. In fermentation, what you're trying to do is cultivate the growth of specific kinds of bacteria that will, enhance the flavor and preserve the food and maintain the safety of it.
Right. And another question a few people have asked, and I've heard this too, people who have, who are on low salt or salt-free diets want to know, what do they do? I mean, is there ways to, I know I've been able to cut the salt a lot. There has to be salt to create, I think, this fermentation, or does there?
Well, I mean, there certainly are traditions of fermenting vegetables that don't use any salt. They don't taste very good. They don't have a very good texture. I mean, salt also helps to slow down these enzymes that will make the vegetables get soft and mushy. I've had quite a bit of salt-free sauerkraut. So, you know, cabbages take much longer to get soft and mushy. So, I think it's a little bit more realistic to do an extremely low salt or no salt sauerkraut than cucumber pickle, because cucumbers just have such a propensity to get soft and mushy, and the salt is really important for preventing that. So I do this daikon kraut that I have. I mean, this has, less than 1% salt, compared to this. I made a 5% salt brine, which is going to equilibrate into about 2 to 2.5%. But this has half as much salt as that. And it's maintained a great texture for a long period of time.
And can people find these percentages in your book, Wild Fermentation?
Yeah, sure. And actually, I'm going to post right now. My website is a recipe for sour pickles, and you'll also find that in Wild Fermentation and also in The Art of Fermentation. Somebody asked where they could find my Pao-cai recipe. That's in my latest book, Fermentation Journeys. And also, anyone who's interested in sort of the things I learned about in China, I made a series of videos that are available for free on YouTube. They're called People's Republic of Fermentation. And one of them is devoted to Pao-cai, and then each one is devoted to a different fermentation process that I was able to learn about.
So we have a lot of, I think we could just be talking for a very long time, and maybe we should talk again. I'll ask this one, do you ferment beets the same way as you do the cucumbers, or how do you ferment beets?
Well, I mean, usually the way I'm fermenting beets is I love to make beetroot kvass. Actually, it's so funny because I'm making a cold borscht that's in the refrigerator, beet kvass is, so beet kvass is like a liquid infusion of beets that's fermented. So that's because I love this so much. That's typically how I've been fermenting beets. But I mean, certainly I've played around with lots of other styles of fermenting beets. I mean, you can just like grate beets and salt them sauerkraut style. You could put whole beets into a brine like we're talking about with sour pickles. And by the way, you can mix vegetables together. I mean, this is exactly the same method that I'm using for cucumbers. I use for string beans. I use for whole pickled okra. And sometimes, particularly at the end of the gardening season, when the frost is about to come, I might pick like sweet peppers, the remaining string beans, even some cucumbers in with that, maybe tiny little zucchinis, and like mix a bunch of different vegetables and put them under a brine and pickle them together. So it doesn't have to just be cucumbers. I mean, I referenced the pickled green tomatoes that my grandfather loved. I mean, you would basically do exactly the same thing, except instead of cucumbers, you would put in green tomatoes. And there's ways of fermenting red tomatoes, but they'll never hold their form. So usually that would be like making a salsa and then fermenting it for a day or two to make it, sour and probiotic. But if you want them to hold their form, then you really need either green tomatoes, or in a Russian cookbook, sometimes you'll find recipes for cherry tomatoes where the tomatoes are just beginning to blush red and they'll still hold their shape.
We're really approaching a season where the farmer's market is full of vegetables we can pickle, or if you're lucky enough to have a garden. So it's a perfect time to be talking. I do want to ask, a couple of people have asked about different alternatives to, I'm just looking, there's a lot about salt, but we just covered that. There was something I was surprised by.
I do see a question. The last question that's there is, would the veggies need to be like size if you ferment them together? And not necessarily. I mean, the larger vegetables might take a little bit longer for the brine and the salt to reach the center, but only marginally so. So, I've mixed things of different sizes. And by the way, for anyone who doesn't know, in Southeastern Europe, I saw this in Croatia, but throughout the lands, like the Balkan states that used to be Yugoslavia, the people typically don't shred cabbage to make sauerkraut. Typically, they ferment whole heads of cabbage. And then if they want to make sauerkraut, they'll slice them after the fermentation. But the amazing thing that people do with that is they peel off the entire leaves of cabbage and then use those fermented leaves of cabbage for sarma and other kinds of, you know, stuffed cabbage delicacies. Which reminds me that these grape leaves at the bottom, you don't have to throw these out at the end, you know, make dolmas. What I do is all season, the little batches of pickles that I make, I save all the grape leaves and the garlic in a jar under brine in the fridge. And then at the end of the season, I'll make dolmas with, all of those fermented grape leaves. And you know, in terms of the garlic, I mean, I'll use that for anything.
I'm getting very hungry, I confess. The additive I was wondering about, people are asking about calcium chloride, and I'm not familiar with it, but can that keep the pickles crisp? And then I have one last question.
Well, I've never heard of people doing calcium chloride for raw fermented pickles. I've mostly seen that in recipes for like vinegar pickles. And I've no experience with it, so I don't know that, you know, that it couldn't be done, but I have no experience with it.
Okay.
And then the way that works is like, it's a chemical reaction that makes the flesh of the cucumber like firmer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hadn't heard of it myself. Why don't we end by your giving a little background? A few people have asked us, what got you started pickling and what kind of experiments did you begin with? And maybe you can even tell us if you have a favorite vegetable or fruit to pickle, but really what got you started? Let's end with a little more about you.
Yeah, sure. So, as I said, like as a kid, I loved pickles, and I had a little reputation in my family for if the pickles were all gone from the fridge, probably I was the one who ate them. So I've always been drawn to the flavor of pickles. Mm-hmm. 30 years ago, I moved from New York to rural Tennessee. I basically became part of a commune, and I jumped right into gardening and cooking for people. And the first season that I was gardening, we had this like beautiful row of cabbages, and I was like, oh my God, you know, I was such a naive city kid that I'd never really thought about the idea that in a garden, all of the cabbages would be ready at the same time. When we had this beautiful row of cabbage, I was like, oh my God, what are we going to do with all these cabbages? And then I was like, I think sauerkraut has something to do with ferment with preserving cabbage. And I know I love sauerkraut. I looked in the joy of cooking. I learned how to make sauerkraut from the joy of cooking. And then I just started playing around like, oh, okay. That was deceptively simple. That was, you know, really delicious. You know, well, what happens if I use turnip instead of cabbage? What happens if I mix a few different vegetables together? I wonder how I can make the kind of, you know, cucumber pickles that I grew up with. And, you know, I just started, you know, looking through cookbooks, trying things, experimenting, but, you know, it was sort of based on this sort of like lifelong love of pickles and wanting to like you know, capture these flavors. And, you know, I mean, for me, I mean, nothing is better than a cucumber pickle. I mean, you know, it continues to be a real favorite thing of mine. But what I will say about fermentation traditions is that, you know, people, I mean, in every part of the world, people ferment what is abundant. You know, people are not fermenting, you know, sort of precious, hard to find things. They're fermenting the things that are in great abundance. So I have this farmer friend who plants daikon radishes on acres of land as a cover crop, and then he just plows them back in. But he lets me come with a pickup truck every year, and I can fill up a pickup truck with daikon radishes and not even make a dent. So, you know, so I've been fermenting daikon radishes because they are abundant in my life. And they're delicious. I mean, you know, if they weren't delicious, I wouldn't ferment them just because they were abundant, but they're really very delicious as well. I also want to just point out, in case like people haven't noticed, my shirt has pickle, a pickle motif.
Pickle where is a coming attraction.
Pickle where and pickle when.
And I hope maybe you'll be traveling around. I know you do turn up in different states at pickle festivals, and you run some seminars.
I'm really like a full-time fermentation educator, and I host things here where I am. I do online events like the one we're in the middle of right now. I travel different. I was actually in the Hudson Valley a few weeks ago. There was a fermentation festival in New Paltz, New York. You know, so I travel lots of different places and teach about fermentation.
And I'm sure we can follow some of your travels on your website, correct?
Exactly. Wildfermentation.com is my website. And you can find out about my books and the classes that I teach. And I just post, you know, my whole schedule. This event has been up there. And you can see what I have coming up in the next few months.
So I want to thank everyone. And I know Ariel is coming back to close us out, but it's been incredible. And I've thoroughly enjoyed our conversation, Sandor.
All right. Okay. I see someone who's watching is a student at Middle Tennessee State University, which is 25 miles from where I live, has a fermentation sciences program.
Amazing.
You know, fermentation is a huge industry. And there are a lot of fermentation programs like that that are cropping up.
And if I just can put one incentive in too, some people have put in the chat that they've had connections to the Worker Circle. Why don't you email us at info@circle.org, and we'd love to talk to you and find out about your history. We're approaching our 125th year, and we're looking for stories, and we'd love for you to get involved in our activism today. So it's been really fun to see so many people sharing such incredible stories, pickling and otherwise. And I know where I'm gonna be this weekend. If any of you are on the Lower East Side, there's a better than average chance you'll find me at the Pickle Guys.
Okay.
Well, thank you all so, so much, Ann and Sandor. This has been a complete delight. Thank you to everyone who's here and for all of your participation and sharing all of your stories and memories. It's such a beautiful hour and 15 minutes of a community. So I'm really grateful to be here with all of you.